As the last topic in our chapter, multidimensional data, we will now talk about metric space indexing. Remember in the discussions before on multidimensional data, we assumed that these points in the multidimensional space are given by coordinates. For instance, 2D geo-coordinates or 3D coordinates and so on. So basically this means we knew how the points look like and we can index them accordingly using, for instance, R-trees or quad-trees. In metric space indexing, we do not know anything about the objects in terms of their coordinates. We just have given a bunch of objects and a distance measure between them. And metric space indexing uses this distance measure in order to create index structures without any assumptions about something like coordinates. One approach here is the so-called generalized hyperplane partitioning. This partitioning creates a tree that we call generalized hyperplane tree, GH tree. More details later, but what you see here are objects, these black dots, and from these objects we pick two objects specifically. We call these pivots, pivot 1 and pivot 2. These are marked here in red. And then we can separate the objects in our data set into two partitions, separated by the hyperplane between these two pivots. Here we have all points which are closer to P1 than to P2, and here we have all points which are closer to P2 than P1. So if we now take, in order to construct a tree, we take the pivot pair P1 and P2, and we say here on the left side of the tree, we put this partition, and on the right hand side, we take this partition. And then we recursively apply the same. We take again pivots and so on. So this in the end creates a binary tree, the generalized hyperplane tree based on this partitioning principle. You see, we don't make any assumptions about how these objects look like. We just assume that we have a distance function, a metric, and this gives us for two points or objects, object 1, object 2, the distance between these two objects. Based on this, we can construct a tree. The next one is called ball partitioning. Here again, we pick a pivot from the given points we want to partition. And then we assign, given a radius parameter r, we assign the points inside this ball to the left child node of a tree and outside to the right subtree. That means if we have a tree, we say here we have a node containing the pivot, and then this subtree here contains everything inside the ball and this subtree contains everything outside the ball. Doing this recursively with another pivot and another pivot creates again like a binary tree. So if we talk about metric space indexing, it's important for later on understanding how the query processing works. Then we're not only talking about the distance function, but this distance function has to fulfill the metric space property or the property of being a metric. So we require the distance function to be symmetric. The second criteria is called non-negativity. And the third criteria, which is important, is called triangle inequality, which you all probably know already. You have two points, then the distance, the direct distance between these points is smaller or equal than the distance between the first and the third point and the third point and the second point, right? So if we have these properties, we can derive the following lemma. Let me say first why we require such lemmas. In our construction of index structures, and let's talk about trees, like we have seen earlier, like the ball partitioning and the generalized hyperplane partitioning, we have a query queue and we traverse the tree downwards to find our envisioned query results. Now, when we're arriving at a node, this node stores, in case for the ball partitioning, for instance, one object P, a pivot. And then we have here the subtrees containing more inner nodes or data nodes, depending if they are leaves or inner nodes. So we have basically the query obviously given Q and P as a pivot. And now we want to make a decision, do we have to go down here or down here? So this means there are objects here, O, that we don't know. We only know Q and P, but not O. And this lemma, also the next one, they are trying to bound the distance that we do not know in a way that is useful to make a pruning of the way we traverse this index structure. So looking closer at this lemma, we see here, this is the distance between the query object and O, the object that perhaps is a query result, but we don't know exactly how this looks like, so we don't know this distance here. And this lemma gives us a lower bound and an upper bound. The lower bound is the absolute value of the distance between the query and the pivot. This one we know, of course, because when we come down the tree, and obviously we know our query, we find this inner node with a pivot P, so we can evaluate the distance function and we get the distance between Q and P. We also know, at least roughly, the distance between the object which is indexed here or here regarding the pivot. Remember the ball partitioning? So we know that everything in the left-hand tree has a distance smaller or equal than R, or larger than R on the right-hand side. So if we know that, we can derive a bound, which is the lower bound for the unknown distance. Additionally, if we take the sum between the distance between P and Q and P and O, we get the upper bound. Now this looks, of course, in the beginning a bit scary, but look at the illustrations here and it will become very clear. So here we illustrate the lower bound. So if you assume we have the pivot here, and here's our query object, what is the closest distance between the query object Q and the point O? Well, if O is here, then this here is the smallest distance we can get. It's the lower bound. Here, the blue one depicts the real distance between Q and O, which we do not know. So why is this red one now a lower bound? Well, look, O could be, if we know P and O, the distance here, this could also be like here, the O, right? Or here, in this illustration, of course, it's here. And if we move it here, this O, which is the closest, obviously, to Q, then this distance here is just the distance between P and Q minus the distance between P and O. And this is the lower bound. So we cannot get closer than this. To understand the upper bound, well, we know again that we have a distance between P and O, which is giving us this circle here. And how do we have to move now this object O around this circle that the distance between Q and O is the largest? Well, we put it here, right? So what's then the distance between, or what's the distance between now Q and O? Well, it's the distance between P and Q plus the distance between O and P. Here's our upper bound. Not so difficult to see, I hope. So the second lemma is working in a similar way. we again have an object O that we don't really know, and P is our pivot. And we have an object Q, which is our query object. And now this lemma tells how the distance between Q and O, which we don't know, can be bound by assuming the location or the distance between the object O and P being between being in bounds expressed by R low and R high. Again, let's have a look at the illustration. We have here our pivot in the middle. We have here location of object O. And what we assume here is that we do not know the real distance between P and O. We only know roughly the location of O, which is between the radius R high and the radius R low. That means O is located in this kind of, let's say, donut, right? Looks a bit like this. It's breakfast time, apparently. Okay, so now what can we say? So what is the closest distance between the object O and our query point Q in order to understand what is the lower bound? So if Q is here located, then the best possible, the closest O would be here, right? So what's now the distance between Q and this object O? Well, it's this arrow here, right? This distance. How big is that? Well, it's R low. This is R low, right? Minus the distance between P and Q. See here? Then, for another location of Q2, or of Q, let's say we have it here, outside this R high radius. Well, what is the closest O we can think of in this illustration? It's here, right? So then the closest distance according to this position of this object O is this one here. How large is this? Well, it's the distance between P and Q minus R high, which is the radius here. And this is this part. And applying this max here takes care of these two different situations, that Q1 is outside the R1 radius or inside the R low radius. In case O is located, well, sorry, in case Q is located inside the same donut kind of thing, then the minimum distance, of course, is zero, which is captured by this zero here. Right, in the case of Q3, it could happen that O is exactly the same distance, zero to Q3, and then this kicks in here. And looking at the upper bound, similarly to the illustration or the discussion on the previous slide, so we have here the upper bound, the distance between Q and P plus R high. So if we have here Q1, what's the maximum distance between Q1 and O? Well, this happens if O is located here. So then we have this huge distance, right? And how big is the distance? Well, it's the distance R high plus the distance between P and Q, as you can see. Okay, we will later see how we make use of this in order to bound the space or to prune the space we have to look at when we're doing a search in our index structures. So let's more precisely define index structures in metric space. Here we see the vantage point tree, VP tree, and this is exactly making use of a partitioning based on pivots and the radius. This corresponds to the ball partitioning illustration from before. This VP tree is also called like a ball partitioning tree. And vantage point means simply viewpoint or lookout point. So how this works is we have a set of query objects, only of objects in our data. We want to index them. So how do we do this? Well, we select a pivot object, and then we calculate the median from all the distances here regarding the pivot. And then this radius is taken as the parameter r. And then we form two partitions using the pivot p and the radius or the median r. First, we have the set S1 consisting of all points except for the pivot, where the distance between the point and the pivot is smaller than r, strictly smaller in this definition. And here the set S2, which is all points except for the pivot, where the distance between the pivot and this object is larger or equal than r. Doing this recursively creates a binary tree. For every pivot, we see it as a node of the tree, and then having subtrees indexing objects or the data objects in the set S1 and S2. Right? And if you apply this recursively, we have another pivot here based on S1 and another radius. And here we have another pivot based on S2. And accordingly, we apply the algorithm and we get a binary tree. The leaves can be either configured to contain a single object, or if we want, in the capacity, there's no constraint on the capacity or like larger constraint, there can be multiple objects inside the leaf nodes. So here's an illustration of the vantage point tree I took from the book by Hanan Samet. You see, we have a tree depiction on the right side and the ball partitioning accordingly on the left side. So here we see that the first pivot we picked was apparently object I. And according to I, we were creating the radius and then the ball partitioning. And you see here, this is object I. This is the radius. So this is the ball. And this ball partitions now the objects into the objects which are inside the ball, which are in this subtree, and the objects outside, which are in this subtree. And then we apply the same again recursively. So we will pick inside here another pivot. In this case, you see it is S. We create a ball inside this left subtree around S. So you see the ball is restricted to the previous S1 set, so the inside of the ball around I. So it's not capturing this part, obviously, because this is not in this subtree. Well, and then we get again around S the ones which are inside this part here, which is this subtree, and the stuff which is outside, which is this part, and so on. And if we have now a query object Q, we want to find like points which are in a certain neighborhood of this query point. For instance, we say query Q and the parameter epsilon, and we want to find all points which have a distance smaller or equal than epsilon to Q. Then we can now go for this root node here and decide where we have to look, to this one or to this one. It can happen that we have to look in both subtrees, and we will understand in a few minutes precisely a rule when we have to look here or here, or we can avoid looking in one of these subtrees. For a better example, let's have a look at this illustration. So we have a radius epsilon around the query object Q, and you see here is Q, and here's the radius around. Now, in this illustration, you see here the pivot and the radius R around the pivot. Now here, this illustration should make clear that in this case, having P in the node in the tree and spanning subtrees, which are indexing the objects in S1 here and in S2 here. In this illustration, it's evident that we do not have to look in S1 because the ball here does not intersect with the ball around the pivot. So we don't have to look in any of these points because none of these points has a chance to be our query result, because the query result contains only those points which are in an epsilon radius around the query point Q. Obviously, we have to look in S2 because S2 is this entire space around the pivot, which is not in the ball but around, right? And obviously here we see that this ball around the query intersects or fully falls into this pink area, which is S2. So we have to look here, but not here. Another example, here we see the pivot again and the radius. And now the query object is here with a certain radius epsilon. And you see that this ball around the query object intersects with this ball around P, meaning that here in this example it's actually true. There is some result inside S1. So in this case, we cannot prune away S1 or S2. We have to look in both branches or both child nodes of the node around the pivot. So we have to go down the tree here and also here. Now let's say we have a query point which is here and a certain radius around it. Under which circumstances do we have to look in S1? We have to look in S1 if the radius here is intersecting at least a little bit with this circle around P, our S1 partition. When does this happen? Well, it happens if the distance between P and our object Q here, which we know of course, minus the radius is smaller or equal than epsilon. Right? This is exactly the what we have written here. Is exactly the distance from the bound of this circle to the query P, Q. If this here is smaller or equal than epsilon, then we have to look in S1, otherwise not. So on this slide you see that summarized again. What we just depicted on the previous slide was this case. The question when we have to look at the left subtree, which we called S1, and this is exactly what I have illustrated. This happens if the distance between the query point and Q minus R is smaller or equal than epsilon, and for the case when the query point falls into the ball around the pivot, then again this here is capturing this case. In a similar way, we can derive a rule when we have to look at the right subtree, S2, by saying we have to look at it if R minus the distance between P and Q is smaller or equal than epsilon. And the idea is the same. We look at our radius around P. We say there's a query falling into here, which is around Q and with epsilon, of course. And then the question is, when do we have to look at S2, which is outside, of course? Well, we have to look at it if this ball around Q is touching is intersecting with S2. And when does this happen? Well, it happens exactly when we have here this radius R. And minus R, so R minus this distance between P and Q is smaller or equal than epsilon. That means this distance here is smaller or equal than epsilon. In this case, this ball would intersect with S2. And this is exactly like this here. And again, the zero is capturing the case when the query point falls into S2 anyway, and then we would have to look anyway in S2. Now, remember this complicated looking lemma? Well, this is just giving you what you need as a proof to make these two statements. If you go back to this lemma and you're setting R low to 0 and R high to R, and then by applying this lemma or reading the lemma, you get exactly this result for the left subtree that you also see here below. And if you're setting R low to R and R high to infinite, then you're getting the result in the bottom here. The next tree we look at is the hyperplane tree, the generalized hyperplane tree called GH tree. We pick two pivots, P1 and P2, and then we partition the remaining objects into two sets, S1 and S2. Here S1 is defined as the objects in S, not including the pivots, where the distance between the object and P1 is smaller than the distance between the object and P2, smaller and equal or equal. And S2 contains those objects without the pivots, where the distance between P2 and the object is strictly smaller than the distance between P1 and the object. So this basically means that we have to store these two pivots in our nodes in the tree, and then these pivots create two subtrees, S1 and S2, containing those objects which are closer to the pivot P1 or to P2. And if you apply this recursively, we end up having a binary tree, the generalized hyperplane tree. Here's an example how this partitioning can look like. You see, first we do the partitioning based on this purple or pink line, and then we create subpartitions based on these blue hyperplanes and then this light blue hyperplanes. In the end, the tree structure looks like this. First, you can also go back then and look at the slide before, looking now with the knowledge that we have A and B taken as the pivots, and then C and D here and E and F here, you see how the tree is partitioning the space of objects. And again, we do not know the real, let's say, coordinates. There might not be any coordinates. This is not indexing two-dimensional or three-dimensional objects. Of course, in the illustrations, to make that clear, in illustrations we usually draw two-dimensional data points, but here we don't assume anything. We only assume that we have a metric distance function, and we don't assume that we know that this is point. These are points in a multi-dimensional space. We don't assume that. Right? We just have a distance function. We don't look at the space behind it. So if we have now a query object, we can go down the tree again, starting from the root. And we want to find again all those objects which are falling into an epsilon distance around the query point. And now we have to again understand in which circumstances we can avoid looking at some subtrees and looking only at one subtree, or in which cases we have to look at both subtrees. For the generalized hyperplane tree, we have the following lemma. We assume here we have an object O, which is closer to P1 than to P2, or equally far away. So in this illustration, you see the object O being here placed. So that means we know that the distance between O and P1 is smaller or equal than the distance between O and P2. So, and again, here the decision is, do we have to look at the right subtree or only at the left subtree? At the left subtree, we anyway have to look, because you see this object O is falling into this part, or this part here, left of the hyperplane. So we have to look at the left subtree anyway. The question is, do we have to look at the right subtree, which indexes this space? And the answer is, well, this depends, of course, on the distance between the query Q and the hyperplane, which is here depicted like this. And this distance can be expressed as a difference between the distances of the query to the two pivots divided by 2. And that means if we have again to consider our parameter, that we don't know, right? This parameter or the information about the query and the object, we can make the following statement that the distance that we don't know, Q and O, O can be placed somewhere here. We don't know exactly where it is. We just know that it is in this region here, but we don't know exactly the distance here. But we can say that this distance is larger or equal than the distance that we have just derived here, or we have seen, and zero again capturing the case when this object O is actually falling into this part here, right, as before. So how can we now use this information? Well, we can use it just like, as I said, we can now take this bound and say, if this here is larger than epsilon, that means Q in this illustration here is so far away from the hyperplane that the ball, if you draw a ball with epsilon radius around, cannot touch the region indexed by P1. Right? So if you're drawing here a radius epsilon, in this case you see the epsilon ball around Q is not touching the partition indexed by the pivot P1. So there cannot be any results in this pink shaded region. And this is exactly then the outcome or the use of this lemma for pruning the space when researching the generalized hyperplane tree. So we have a range query as depicted before. We have a point Q and the radius epsilon around. This is our range query, right? And then we can say, according to the following observation, that the left subtree needs to be visited only. So if and only if this here is smaller or equal than epsilon, and the other way around, the right subtree needs to be visited if and only if the here this fraction is smaller or equal than epsilon. So similarly to the VP tree, we have now derived a pruning rule that guides us the way down the tree and helps us to eliminate to visit subtrees which cannot contain any valid query result. There's more on metric space indexing, of course, in particularly the book by Hanan Samet. It contains many other ways. Similarly to the discussion on multidimensional data indexing in the d-dimensional space using quadtree and KD-tree, I already mentioned there that these index structures are not really designed for block storage devices. Also, you can, let's say, play around with the capacity of the nodes in the leaves. And similarly to what the R-tree was compared to the quadtrees, the M-tree is now a variant or a tree for indexing metric space based on the concept of the R-tree. We have some block-based access to external memory, so our hard disk, and M-trees are very similar to R-trees. If you look at the R-tree, we have these inner nodes that contain pointers to subtrees, and these pointers were annotated by minimum bounding rectangles that would describe the space these subtrees are indexing. And instead of having rectangles, well, we have pivots and radiuses around the pivot stored in the M-tree inner nodes. So instead of these indexing using rectangles, like for the R-tree, now we're indexing the space using pivots and radiuses around pivots. And of course, this can happen that these radiuses around the pivots or these balls around the pivots, they're intersecting, and the behavior then is similar to the R-tree in terms of how do we query the M-tree. We go down from the root, of course, and have to visit all of the entries of an inner node which are intersecting with our query range. The paper corresponding to the M-tree is given here. It's also a very interesting, good read. To be more precise, the inner nodes have the form P. So the inner node entries have the form. So if this is again an inner node, we have multiple entries, like according to our capacity of these inner nodes. And each of these entries here has this form. The pivot, of course, as illustrated. The radius, describing the ball or defining the ball around the pivot. The distance to the parent node, there's actually some optimization trick you can make use of this information to further prune the search. And T is of course the pointer to the subtree corresponding to this ball. When you're inserting an object similarly to the R tree, you're running down the tree from the root to the leaves, and then you're finding a node that encloses the object you want to insert. And then, if possible, you're trying to insert it there, causing the smallest increase in case it does not fit entirely in. So this means basically that you have to adapt the radius like we would adapt the minimum bonding rectangle of the R tree. You have to adapt now these radiuses. And then, of course, they're also propagating up in the tree. These radius increases and so on. It's like almost identical to the way the R tree is constructed. And here we also do not assume anything about coordinates or d-dimensional spaces. Here we only assume that we know the distance function, which has to be a metric, and then we can index our objects.